Welcome to First Good Memorial. Thank you so much for joining us for worship this morning. Please join us if you have the words at home or if you know the song to singing This I Believe or the Creed.
We come before God not to glorify war, but but to honor and celebrate those who walked into the chaos and evil that is war. Those who were civilians, and those who were military. Those who braved the censure of society, that means criticism, and those who gave of themselves for that society. Those who survived, and those who didn't. And those who were friends, and those who were enemies.
None who have waded through the evil, death, and sorrow of war are untouched in body, mind, or spirit. They are beloved of God. Therefore, let us open our hearts to worship the God who is aggrieved for all who suffer war.
Sisters and brothers, God not only desires our repentance, he longs to offer us forgiveness. Therefore, cast all your anxiety on God, because God cares for you eternally. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we usually know how you would have us resolve the differences which arise between sisters and brothers, neighbors and nations. But it is not an easy choice for us when our passions and principles do not align with your perfect will. Forgive us, we pray, whenever we place our will above your will. Heartbreak and agony above peace and brotherhood.
And now hear the assurance of forgiveness. Sisters and brothers, the Spirit of God is resting on you to restore, support, and strengthen you. Therefore, be at peace in the one who forgives you and loves you. Rise up and give God thanks. And now a summary of the law. Hear the teaching of Jesus Christ. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you.
You well. I had something planned for the children, a message that I thought was perfect. But you know what, kids? I can't do it. I woke up late, I was rushing around to get the Zoom meeting all scheduled. And that's what happens. We rush. And I'm thinking, what can I do to stop the rush? I have to stop and pray. Do you ever get so upset that you forget to pray? So just stop for a minute. I see these commercials on TV now where it gives that calm thing just to sit there for 30 seconds. I'm sitting here for 5 hours. I don't need to sit for 30 more seconds and be quiet. Come on. How many times in a day do we get angry with ourselves or with somebody else and then we forget the golden rule? So we have to stop and pray. And just think about what God wants for us. I know it's hard. We're all home. We're all getting tired of seeing each other all the time. But you can do it. Why does God do this? Why is this happening? We may never know. But we do know that we can live in this moment knowing that God has a plan for us. We just need to listen. We need to stop and pray. So if your brother or your sister or your cousin or your aunt or your grandmother or grandfather, somebody is driving you crazy because you don't have any way out, just stop for a minute, okay? Maybe hug something like my little unicorn that I have and just say a prayer. So let's pray. Okay? Dear God, thank you for being there for me. For when life gets crazy, I can stop and say a prayer and let you show me the way to be. Amen. Amen. Please join me in a prayer for illumination. Spirit of glory, Spirit of God, bless us with the word of life this day to restore, support, and strengthen us as we seek to be one with you and with each other. Amen. This morning's scripture lesson is taken from the first letter of Peter. I didn't even remember that Peter had two letters, and they're very small. So they're easy to read if you want to go back and look at them. The first letter of Peter, chapter 4, verses 12 through 14, and chapter 5, verses 6 through 11. Let's hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery ordeal that is taking place among you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you. But rejoice insofar as you are sharing Christ's suffering, so that you may also be glad and shout for joy when his glory is revealed. If you are reviled for the name of Christ, you are blessed, because the Spirit of glory, which is the Spirit of God, is resting on you. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that he may exalt you in due time. Cast all your anxiety on him because he cares for you. Discipline yourselves. Keep alert. Like a roaring lion, your adversary, the devil, prowls around looking for someone to devour. Resist him, steadfast in your faith, for you know that your brothers and sisters in all the world are undergoing the same kinds of suffering. And after you have suffered for a little while, the God of all grace, who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself restore, support, strengthen, and establish you. To him be the power forever and ever. Amen. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
All right. said it was going to be easy? I want to know. I want names. Because so much isn't easy. We're looking today especially at the first letter of Peter, chapter 5, verse 8, where he wrote, "Discipline yourselves. Keep alert. Like a roaring lion, your adversary, the devil, prowls around, looking for someone to devour." Your adversary, the devil, prowls around, looking for someone to devour. Who said it was going to be easy? While it's true that some things come easily for us because of natural abilities or intellect or disproportionate investment in someone's time in us, teaching, explaining, demonstrating, practicing, we don't often think of us having things come easily to us. We think of the things that do not come easily to us that other people seem to do easily. And we spend time feeling sorry for ourselves and resenting them. Well, some of us do. Well, I do. What can I tell you? But it seems to me from my vantage point on life that most things, most important things, most things that get a lot of attention from others don't come easily. Most things of any value seem to require a lot of work, a lot of study, a lot of repetition, a lot of time, a lot of focus, a lot of perspiration. Even investing ourselves in all of that, the work, the study, the repetition, the time, and so forth, even investing ourselves in all of that is no guarantee for success. Sometimes things just don't click for us. They don't fall into place for us. We don't understand them. We can't do them. And it's very frustrating. I'm currently two-thirds of the way through reading Edwin Morris's 783-page biography of Thomas Alva Edison that was published last year. You remember Edison, America's best-known inventor? In reading in more detail, I've followed Edison for a lot of my life. I'm fascinated by him. But in reading this book, it becomes even more clear, more substantiated, that he didn't eat a lot, and he slept less, and he was, for the most part, an absentee husband and father. Perhaps of the criticism that he received at various places throughout his life, he was sort of defensive about his self-esteem, and could be petty with people who were working on competing ideas or projects, and he wanted to be the one who delivered the product, the one who solved the problem, the one who invented something new. And he literally tried thousands of different materials to make the filaments of his light bulbs more reliable, burn brighter, be more convenient and more practical. In addition to that, he made improvements in Alexander Graham Bell's telephone, and at the other end of the spectrum, with many things happening to him and doing for him in between, he lost a fortune of his own money because it was hard to get people to invest in him unless they saw a ready and astronomical profit advantage to them. but he was passionate about iron and about mining iron and producing iron that could be used for manufacturing purposes. And so he spent more money than I can count, and more money than I will ever see, at plants that he built and a mine that he opened in Ogden, New Jersey, and later on Sparta Mountain, where he pioneered rock crushing technology that had never been done that way before, and where he invented electromagnetic ore separation to get the iron out of the rock and its other components. To the casual student of Edison's life and work, he had an astronomical number of patents, which speak about his successes, not his failures, not his frustrations. But he had more of them than he had patents. He appears to the casual student to be an indefatigable fountain of creativity when it comes to ideas and practical resolutions to issues of botany, defense, chemistry, magnetism, light, the generation of electricity, recording and playing back sound, motion pictures, telegraphy, and frankly, far too many for me to be able to list in their entirety in the time we have together today. All this flowed out of a fellow that was judged poorly and critically by his teachers and received more criticism than encouragement. His mother took him out of school finally and took him at home, or I don't know where he would have ended up. His employers were harsh with him at times, but he didn't work for many. He quickly maneuvered his life situation to working for himself. One of his employers, when he was still a teenager, and he was working on selling newspapers on the train, and he had set up a little chemistry lab in the back corner of one of the luggage cars, I guess it was, and unintentionally set it on fire. And the conductor came and boxed him in the ears to the point where he spent the rest of his life with a growing deafness on that side. With what we know of him today, can you imagine what the conductor didn't know? The damage he didn't know he was creating, the pain he was introducing into an already intense life. None of Edison's achievements came easily. And many of his ideas and principles that he tried to harness to put together should have worked. They made sense. They fell into line with what he had known and learned about science and engineering and chemistry and physics. But with all his knowledge, self-taught to a large extent, but real knowledge nonetheless, things didn't just click together for him. It took tremendous effort and tremendous focus. One of Edison's most famous quotations is that success is more perspiration than it is inspiration. These ideas that kept coming to him, and he kept notebooks, and when he was traveling or when he was sitting in a quiet moment in his study, he wrote notebooks full of ideas. He was even writing them on his second honeymoon. His first wife died. They never seemed to stop flowing, but they never seemed to work easily. The longer I live, the more I appreciate differentiate that in a manner of speaking. 2 plus 2 doesn't always equal 4. Even though we both know that it does. And yet, in practical terms, it doesn't always. And I'm not speaking about mathematically, I'm speaking figuratively. That is especially on my mind today as I think about Memorial Day, a weekend holiday that is very important to me, not because it's the beginning of summer, because I spent most of my life at the shore, and Memorial Day meant we lost the shore, those of us who lived there, to the Bennies, who came down there and took over the restaurants, and took over the stores, and took over the beaches, and couldn't wait for Labor Day until we all went home and we got it back for ourselves for the rest of the year. Who said it's not all about me? I know I said that last week, but I'm so far from perfect. Memorial Day weekend is about people who gave everything so that we can have everything we have. America is the land of the free because of the brave. I'm sorry to be so trite, but I can't ignore that statement because it is so true. In my love of history, I've studied a lot, I've read a lot, I've listened to people who've lived history and soaked up their stories. I had an elder when I was in Tin Falls who was in his late 90s at the time that he was our annual commissioner from the congregation I served to Presbytery. So almost once a month, he and I would spend at least a half an hour in the car driving someplace. And I couldn't wait for him to get in the car because I knew it would only take one question to prime the pump. And he would gush with the details and intimate observations of great moments in history, some of which I'd thought about and wondered about before, and some of which had never occurred to me to think about. Beginning from the time he enlisted in the cavalry, when the cavalry meant horses, not helicopters. So we're talking about a fair amount of history. And he knocked a few of my favorite people in history off of their pedestals because he knew them, he worked with them, and he saw them at their worst as well as at their best. But I loved listening to George. Among other reasons that I miss him now, I buried him when he was 103. I wish he was still here, like I wish my dad was still here. Although Dad wouldn't talk about World War II because he had PTSD before we knew what PTSD was. And he passed on before we knew what PTSD was. But I'm proud of what little I gleaned from what he did tell me about his experiences, especially the trauma of the Battle of the Bulge. To this very day, I appreciate friends and relatives who served in the Vietnam War in ways I can't begin to tell you. Some of them came home, some of them did not, and some later died because of cancer from Agent Orange and other environmental things that they were exposed to while they were there. One of the reasons why I love Dover, the town of Dover so much, is because of the banners that are on the light poles up and down Blackwell Street with the names and photos of servicemen and women. I can't drive from where I live on the western edge of Denville to here without being reminded of the service and sacrifice of so many people I will never know, but to whom I owe so much. So you see, Memorial Day is really profoundly important to me. And yet I am troubled by the fact that even in serving, to be made do not always come to us because 2 + 2 = 4. Do you remember Desmond Doss? Anybody know that name? Desmond Doss, after growing up with a very lively relationship with his older brother, they would tangle and fight every day, tumbling and rolling around on the front lawn, causing their mother hysterics. One day, Desmond was taking a particularly bad beating while he was pinned on his back by his older brother, and he was reaching around with his hand for anything he could find on the ground, and somehow there was a brick that his hand came to rest on. He picked it up and smashed his brother in the head with it and knocked him out cold. And his initial reaction to that, as he watched his parents become hysterical — he didn't kill him, by the way — but as he watched his parents, you know, try to revive his brother, his initial reaction was, "I've killed him." And Desmond was raised in the church, and he believed what he was taught, and he certainly believed in the Ten Commandments. And his mother said to him over and over again that the most grievous thing you can do to God is to kill another human being. So when the Second World started and all his friends went off and enlisted, he had a job at a factory to produce war material, so he had an exemption. But he didn't feel he could just stay home and be comfortable when everybody else was putting themselves in harm's way. So he decided to enlist in the army as a conscientious objector, because he, with all that killing that was going on around him, wanted to be able to save lives. He wanted to be a medic. And so he read everything he could about medicine before he went into the military. And while he was in basic training, everything was going fine until they tried to hand him a gun, his M1 rifle. And he just shook his head and said, "I'm sorry, I can't even touch that thing." And they went bananas on him. His superiors were all over his case. They said terrible things about him, demeaned his character, told the rest of his group in his barracks that they couldn't depend on him, because he would go off in the corner, he would probably go off in the corner and pray rather than pick up a weapon and protect them from the enemy. They never let him say in public, when they were berating him, what his motivations were and why he had this position on not even touching a rifle. Through a variety of circumstances that unfolded while he was in basic training and while he was in a military court of justice, being charged with insubordination, he got cleared to be allowed to function in the army as a conscientious objector and not take up arms. And following that, he was deployed to Okinawa. And if you know much about the Pacific War during World War II, that was a brutal place. Every place in the Pacific was a brutal battle for people. But this one was incredible. And while he was an army medic in Okinawa, treating men on the ground after they had fallen, getting them to safety so they could be transported to a field hospital, he was hit by a grenade. He took bullets from snipers. At the height of a battle, where his entire regiment was almost wiped out, he stayed up on the top of the hill and retreated and rescued by carrying or dragging 75 soldiers to the edge of a cliff where he tied a rope around each one and lowered them a couple hundred feet to the ground where there were jeeps waiting to carry anybody that managed to get down from where the battle was to safety. Some of the men whose lives he saved were the men who had in the dormitory, or in the barracks rather, had beaten him mercilessly, tied him up and wrapped him up in blankets and kicked him and punched him and just brutalized him. He saved their lives. And as a result of that, he was the only, or he was the first conscientious objector, excuse me, he was the first conscientious objector to be awarded the Congressional Medal of Honor, which was pinned on him by President Truman. Now you would think, with his motivation and his beliefs, that he was doing a noble thing, a thing that inspired great courage to go into battle unarmed, to rescue people who had fallen, putting his life at great risk. You would think 2 + 2 = 4, and that was a noble thing, and the people should have thought the world of him. They should have encouraged him, they should have applauded him. It wasn't until the day after that awful day that he rescued 75 fellows and got them down to the ambulances to take them to the field hospital, that the group he was fighting with really began to appreciate him. In fact, when they were ordered back up to continue the battle the following day, they wouldn't go unless he went with them. But when you're in this kind of situation, you know, the commands about not killing, as well as all the history of all the fighting to defend the honor of God, which is the choice you should make? It's one of those things that is just not easy, but it is profoundly life-changing and life-identifying choices that result from whichever way you go. As a marksman or as a medic. But the thing that makes whichever choice you make okay is, in my limited understanding of life and the world, is the attitude of your heart. God honors the attitude of your heart. God honors your love for him and your love for mankind and womankind and every other kind. Right now I'm having a hard time watching the Smithsonian Channel, which I spend a lot of time with because they are having these heart-rending commercials about all these abused dogs and cats while they're trying to solicit money to continue their work. Just tears me up inside. Cruelty of any nature to any living thing tears me up inside. But how do you make decisions, life and death decisions, when you have conflicting information? I had a very, very important friend to me who, all through her life, and she has tried to live and succeeds living so faithfully, but whenever she came to a crossroads, she asked God for guidance about which fork to take in the road of her life at that moment. And I can't remember a time when God gave her an easy answer. In fact, I can't remember when God gave her a clear-cut answer at all. Linda, if you're listening today, I'm sorry that I'm exposing you, but matter is, God honored every one of your choices, and he honors every one of our choices when our heart is in the right place and when love is at the center of which way we go at a crossroads. So I am grateful for all those who gave their lives and are now giving their lives for us. I'm not a big believer in Saigon or Denver. I didn't buy it then, I don't buy it now. But I so appreciate and so respect everybody who went and did their duty as they saw it, because of the attitude of their hearts for their fellow soldiers, for our nation, for the people, the foreigners that we thought we were protecting and defending. Nobody said it was going to be easy, and nobody really argues with that until you get down and dirty and specific about what the big questions are. But as you ride down Blackwell Street today or any other day, while we're celebrating a holiday like Memorial Day or any other of the great holidays that have to do with duty, honor, country, sacrifice, I wish you would think about 1 Peter 5:8. Discipline yourselves. Repeatedly think and dwell and meditate and pray about the fact that, like a roaring lion, your adversary, the devil, prowls around looking for someone to devour, looking for someone to dishearten, looking for someone to discourage, looking for someone to influence into making the wrong decision, the non-heart-based decision. God is love, and so should we be. Amen.
Thank you.
Friends, we are grateful to have you with us as we worship on this seventh Sunday at Eastertide, which falls on Memorial Day weekend this year. We hope you can be with us in our ministry as well as in our worship, and that you will consider mailing an offering to our church office this week at 51 West Blackwell Street in Dover. We hope that you will participate by doing so in feeding the hungry who gather on our front steps immediately following worship today, and those who come in need of feeding their whole families on Wednesdays during our shopping bag food distributions. You may not see cars in the parking lot, you may not see people walking in and out of our doors, but we are here and this ministry goes on. I'd like to take a special moment of thanks and gratitude to express to Carol and Ed Dorsey, who are at the heart of this ministry and are here masked and gloved several times a week to help those who cannot help themselves. Let us pray. Glorious God, everything that is given to us rains forth out of the abundance of your love, even Jesus Christ our Lord. So we ask you to bless our lives and our gifts, that all we are and all we offer give glory to you, in the name of Jesus, who is the way, the truth, and the life. Amen.
Okay, Karen would like to ask for prayers for Tony, who is having surgery on Wednesday. Ed is asking for prayers for Donna Banks. Her grandsons, Charlie and Michael, help out with the bag lunch program every Sunday after church. She is in Mary Hart with breathing problems. Kim would like to say thank you to those who have sacrificed their lives for us, including Jesus Christ, for our freedom, and to pray for those affected by the virus and those working tirelessly to take care of them. Healing prayers for the town of Dover, for Angel, Diana, those with eyesight issues, those dealing with depression, isolation from staying home and not going out to schools, stores, or restaurants. Our joys this week are for Calvin and Dora's granddaughter, who came home from the hospital this week. She was born early and was in the hospital for over 2 months. And we have birthdays that we're celebrating this week for Kim's granddaughter, Lily, on Tuesday, and her son, Larry, on Thursday. We also have Mrs. Swanson, who's celebrating a birthday this week, and Aiden Kurz. And another joy is that we have sold over 120 dinners for this fish and chips, so it's not too late to get your order in. Unfortunately, the Vacation Bible School Committee did decide to cancel VBS for this summer and postpone. We'll be doing it next summer, so all the money raised from the fish and chips will go towards that, and we'll be able to have an extra special Vacation Bible School next year. So, amen.
Thanks, Katie. I'd also like to ask a personal privilege and request that you all pray for the friend of mine, Vietnam War veteran Jack Sassaman, who died of a heart attack this past week, and all that his family is going through because nobody saw this coming. So it's especially agonizing. Jack Sassaman's family. We believe, so we pray. Gracious, sovereign God, Lord of all nations, on the eve of this Memorial Day, we pause to reflect upon our blessings as a nation and the high cost of those blessings. We offer our prayers of thanks and intercession. We thank you for the freedom we enjoy in this country, for opportunities to flourish, and for the relative security of our homeland. We thank you for those who have served in the armed forces of our country, risking their lives for our liberty. We thank you for those who have given up their lives in service to our nation, sacrificing in such a costly way for the sake of others. Thank you for a day set apart, not just for celebration, but also for solemn remembrance, as we consider the sacrifices of so many in our military. Lord, may we be more aware of just how blessed we are as a nation, and take a whole lot less for granted. May we be more grateful for our blessings, more faithful in stewarding them well, more eager to share them with others. We pray for the families and friends of those who have given their lives in service to our nation. May they be comforted in their sadness. May they be assured that the sacrifice of their loved ones contributes to a worthy cause. May they be proud of those they have lost, entrusting their ultimate fate into your gracious hands. Even as we remember those who have given their lives in the past, we also think of those whose lives are on the line today. We consider especially the men and women who serve in the Middle East and around the world, in any place of conflict and violence. We ask you to protect them, encourage them, bring them home safely, bring them home soon. Give wisdom to the leaders of our armed forces that they might know how best to deploy their troops in the cause of freedom. May their efforts be successful so that peace with justice might be established in our world. Guide those who lead our nation in international affairs. Help them to pursue diplomatic paths to prevent needless conflict wherever possible. May they have your wisdom about when and how to use the military might you have entrusted to us. God of peace, stir in the hearts of the leaders of all nations and in all who would use violence to further their cause. Change their hearts and minds. Give them a passion for peace. Bring an end to the pain, suffering, injustice, and violence in our world. We know, dear Lord, that ultimate peace will not come until their kingdom is here in all its fullness. Until your kingdom is here in all its fullness. Nevertheless, we pray for a foretaste of that future. We ask for the growth of peace. Throughout our world today, so that fewer and fewer men and women will have to risk and even sacrifice their lives, or even to be put in the place of making difficult decisions. We long for the day when people will beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. We long for the day when nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. All praise to you, God of grace, God of mercy, God of justice, God of peace, King of kings, and Lord of lords. Amen. And continuing in prayer, let us feel Jesus' familiar words deep in our hearts as we say, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation. Deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
You are as before there was light. Want to cry?
Again, thank you for being with us today. We sense your prayers, we feel your presence, and we appreciate them. Now let me remind us all that we stand with all the faithful who have gone before us, as well as with all the faithful who will come after us, in one great fellowship of witnesses, of people testifying to the empty tomb, to many appearances thereafter, to answer prayer, divine guidance, and the miracle of life itself. Therefore, let us encourage one another with the faith that has been given to us. Let us lean on one another whenever our faith wavers. And may the voices of praise we have raised here today reverberate throughout the halls of heaven, this day and every day, now and forevermore. May God bless us, everyone.